This video is brought to you by Skillshare. Get 3 months of learning for just 99 cents with the link below. If you asked most of your friends which was faster, the fastest production car in the world or the fastest helicopter, I think most of them would guess the helicopter. Intuitively, we expect anything flying in the air to have a higher top speed than anything on the ground could achieve. But physics is a cruel mistress, and conventional helicopters are doomed to a max speed of just 400 kilometers per hour, with that record being set over 30 years ago by John Trevor Eggington in a Westland Lynx, while just this year, the Egera RS demolished that record driving at 445 kilometers per hour. And sure, you don't have to worry about traffic in your helicopter or those pesky speed suggestions on the road, but the bragging rights for top speed will always go to cars for the rest of time. So how can this be, and what quirks of physics are limiting helicopters from flying faster? First, let's look at what limits a car's top speed. To determine top speed, we first need to identify the forces attempting to slow the vehicle down. In space with no resistance, even a small force can continually accelerate an object until it reaches close to the speed of light, if it is maintained for long enough, which would require a silly amount of energy. On Earth though, every time we provide energy to our vehicle, resistance in the form of air resistance and rolling resistance in the wheels are sapping it away. Eventually, we get to a point where the energy we are providing the vehicle equals the energy being taken away, and the vehicle cannot travel any faster. In the case of cars, the top speed is predominantly determined by air resistance. For now, we will ignore rolling resistance as it's negligible in comparison. The equation for drag force is given by this equation, and the equation for power is simply force times velocity. Rearranging these variables, we get an equation for top speed. Applying this to the Egera RS specs, we find its top speed with a decent degree of accuracy, considering we ignored rolling resistance. Decreasing our drag coefficient and frontal area also increases top speed, but to increase power, we need to increase airflow to cool the engine, so this is a difficult balancing act. We also discovered in a previous video that designing rubber tires capable of withstanding these rotational speeds is an incredibly difficult task, with the Bloodhound SSC opting for aluminium wheels to break the land speed record. These are some of the limiting factors for a car, so what are the limiting factors for a helicopter? Helicopters have to deal with all the same problems as cars in counteracting aerodynamic drag. But first, the helicopter needs to overcome the force of gravity, using the same rotor that will need to provide forward thrust. So is this just an issue of needing more engine power? Partially, yes. The Westland Lynx was powered by not one, but two Rolls-Royce GEM turboshaft engines, each equaling the power of a single Egera RS twin-turbo V8 engine. Yet even with twice the power, it still can't beat it in a straight-line race. How can this be? Let's go on a journey as the helicopter takes off and transitions to forward flight, and see why it can't go any faster, even with stronger material for the blades or more powerful engines. As the Lynx powers up, the blades begin to rotate faster, providing more lift according to this equation, where A is the swept area of the blades, C is the coefficient of lift of the blades, and V is the velocity of the blades. The coefficient of lift depends on a lot of things, like the geometry of the blades and angle of attack, but for the sake of simplicity, we'll assume it is constant. Once the lift is greater than the weight of the helicopter, it begins to rise, and when it equals the weight of the helicopter, it will enter a hover state. Now, to go forward, the pilot will need to transition some of the lift to thrust by angling the rotor disc forward. But here we meet our first problem. Looking downwards, we can see the left side of our blade is moving backwards relative to the direction of travel, and our right-hand side is moving forward relative to the direction of travel. Similar to planes, the aerodynamic surface of the blade will generate more or less lift depending on how quickly it is moving through the air. So our right side generates more lift than our left. To counteract this, the rotor integrates an ingenious little mechanism where the blade can change its angle of attack as it rotates. Here, the advancing blade will lower its angle of attack, thereby lowering its lift, and the retreating blade will increase its angle of attack, increasing its lift. This helps equalize the lift across the rotor disc, but this solution has its limit. As we increase an aerofoil's angle of attack, the lift increases, but eventually we hit a point where flow separation occurs and the aerofoil begins to generate less lift. This is our first speed limit. The helicopter will eventually hit a speed where it cannot adjust the angle of attack any further to compensate for dissymmetry of lift. However, there are solutions to this problem. If we have two blades rotating in opposite directions, we no longer have to compensate for dissymmetry in lift, as the two blades will have the opposite dissymmetry of lift and cancel each other out. This is what allows the Chinook to cruise along faster than any other military helicopter at 315 kilometers per hour. Now we've overcome one speed limit, but even now, the Egera RS is still speeding ahead. The next speed limit we reach is the sound barrier. If we continue to increase forward velocity, the tips of the advancing blade will eventually break the sound barrier. And while planes can handle breaking through the sound barrier with the correct design, they don't need to pass through it several hundred times a minute. This adds to the problems of dissymmetry of lift, but also causes problems with varying stress that fatigue the material of the blades and ultimately lead to failure. This speed limit poses a difficult challenge to overcome in our current configuration. To travel faster, we need to increase thrust. To increase thrust, we need to increase lift. Let's take a look at the equation from before to see how we can do that. We can either increase our rotor speed or increase our blade diameter. Increasing the blade velocity will obviously make us more likely to break the sound barrier, but so will increasing our blade diameter, as the velocity of the blade increases as we travel down the blade. Designers have hit an optimum balance between these two variables already, so that's not an option for increasing speed. So how else can we increase helicopter speed? By converting more of that vertical lift to horizontal thrust. But this poses a new problem. At some point, we're going to hit a point where the helicopter is not generating enough lift to keep itself aloft. The solutions to this problem are hitting a point where we can scarcely call the aircraft a helicopter. Enter the Eurocopter X Cubed, which holds the unofficial helicopter speed record. Unofficial exactly because it is not strictly a helicopter, as it generates a large portion of its forward thrust from vertical propellers. This decreases the burden on the horizontal rotor to generate forward thrust, allowing it to slow its rotational speed, minimizing the impact of our previous speed limits. The rotor can also decrease its rotational velocity as the helicopter gains speed, as more lift is generated from two small wings on either side of the helicopter. These design choices allow the X-Cube to reach a top speed of 472 km per hour, beating the previous record held by the Sikorsky X-2 and demolishing anything ever achieved by a production car. Pushing this design ideology even further, we completely blur the lines of what a helicopter is with tilt rotors like the Osprey. This aircraft has a top speed of 565 km per hour. This combined with its incredible vertical takeoff capabilities that are not hindered by limited weight issues like jet engine powered aircraft like the Harrier, has made it an incredibly versatile tool for the US military. Another incredibly versatile tool that could give you some additional lift is Skillshare. All the animations and illustrations you saw in today's episode were created by me. Just 3 years ago, I knew nothing about animation. I taught myself the basics during one Chinese New Year's holiday while I was living in Malaysia. 1 week later, I knew enough to start experimenting with animation styles and figure out how I wanted this channel to look. A year later again, I uploaded my first video to YouTube and it went viral straight away. Learning new skills gives you opportunities in life. This is why I love working with Skillshare. You can learn from thousands of courses in design, business, technology, and loads more. I learned loads about animation from watching a course from my friends at In a Nutshell. I guarantee you, you will find one course that you will want to learn if you follow this link, and it will get the first 1,000 people a 2-month membership for just 99 cents. So ask yourself right now, what skill have you been putting off learning? What project have you been dreaming of completing but aren't sure if you have the skills to do it? Why not start right now and sign up to Skillshare using the link below? You've nothing to lose and a valuable life skill to gain. As usual, thanks for watching and thank you to all my incredible Patreon supporters. I just opened a Discord server for my Patreon supporters where we can chat and share ideas for videos. The links to my Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook pages are below too.